A Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. A Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. Explain stuff.
Hey everyone, Dr. D here, and in this video we are going to be covering Chapter 14 from our Genetics Essentials Concepts and Connections 4th edition book. This chapter concerns molecular genetic analysis and biotechnology. This is stuff that I am quite familiar with, where having worked in the research labs, there's a lot of neat technology nowadays with regard to genetics and how we can genetically engineer genes. We can modify genes, we can modify organisms, we can sequence genomes, and much, much more. And there's a lot of exciting new findings as well, and a lot of exciting new techniques that have come about in the last decade or so, like CRISPR technology, which is very promising for being able to fix genetic disorders. So let's go ahead and get started. A lot of this chapter is going to cover recombinant DNA technology, also known as genetic engineering, and how genetic engineering is conducted. This is the process of locating, isolating, and altering, and then studying DNA segments. Also, we'll be talking a little bit more about biotechnology in general and the use of these techniques. And we will be... Hi, Gizmo. Gizmo's come to visit, and he's standing right in front of my monitor. Okay. And what I want you to realize is that with recombinant DNA technology, with genetics research in general, we're working at the molecular level, so we can't actually see the DNA. We can't actually see the DNTPs. We can't actually see the enzymes that we're working with. We need to be able to indirectly view our results, and I'll show you how molecular biologists go about doing this. So let's talk about recombinant DNA technology first, how genetic engineering is conducted. Some terms that you'll have to be familiar with and we're going to discuss are restriction enzymes, engineered nucleases, CRISPR-Cas, genome editing, how we view DNA fragments, locating DNA fragments with probes. So these are all concepts that we are going to touch on and that you should be familiar with. So what are restriction enzymes? Restriction enzymes are actually naturally occurring enzymes in microorganisms like bacteria, for instance. And these are enzymes that can recognize stretches of DNA and cut the DNA. So they recognize short stretches of DNA. We're talking 4 to 8 nucleotide long DNA sequences. They can bind to those DNA sequences and cleave the DNA at those specific nucleotide sequences. Okay, so you might wonder, well, if bacteria are making enzymes that cleave DNA, well, how do they prevent their own DNA from getting cleaved by these enzymes? Well, what microorganisms do is they'll methylate their own DNA, and that prevents the enzyme from cutting its own DNA. So there's always two sides to every story. These restriction enzymes are naturally occurring in bacteria, and they're produced to degrade invading DNA. So let's say a virus were to inject its genome into the bacteria, a bacteriophage, let's say, infects E. coli. Well, E. coli has specific restriction enzymes that might be able to recognize some sequences on that, you know, foreign DNA and destroy it. Okay, and it prevents destroying its own DNA because its own DNA is methylated. Does that make sense? However, molecular biologists have cloned the genes for these restriction enzymes. And what they can do is use these restriction enzymes. They can take these enzymes, purify them, and use them to cut the DNA they want to cut, you know, in order to do genetic engineering. It's It's like being able to cut DNA at will, so that you can engineer genes into plasmids or genes out of plasmids, etc. Isn't that interesting? So we've taken a naturally occurring enzyme from bacteria, and we use those enzymes, those DNA cutting enzymes called restriction enzymes, we use them in the research lab in order to cut and paste DNA. And when the cutting is, when the cutting happens, you either have these cohesive ends with overhangs or these blunt ends with no overhangs. So take a look here. These are the different restriction enzymes from different species of bacteria. These are the species of bacteria the restriction enzymes come from. Okay. And these are the short sequences that they recognize. These are called recognition sequences. So for example, EcoRI is probably the most used restriction enzyme, EcoRI. Eco stands for E. coli, so it's E. coli's restriction enzyme 1, if that makes sense. This restriction enzyme from E. coli recognizes the short sequence GAATTC. So you see that's a palindromic sequence. These are usually palindromic sequences. So anywhere in a genome where there is a GAATTC, the restriction enzyme EcoRI recognizes, and it cuts here between this G and A at this arrow, and it cuts here between this A and G at that arrow here. And so you see how it would give a staggered cut like this, this staggered cut. So when you have a staggered cut like this, this leaves sticky ends. Sticky because there could be there are these overhangs that could anneal to one another with hydrogen bonds, and that could provide some stickiness, that could provide annealing. These are called cohesive ends or sticky ends. Sometimes it's called sticky ends or overhangs, right? Overhangs. Whereas for example, high three it recognizes GGCCs and it cuts bluntly, which means it cuts straight across, right? It's a double strand break right across. So there's no sticky overhangs. It's not a cohesive end. It's just a blunt end. So these restriction enzymes can either cut just straight up blunt, or they can cut at a kind of staggered arrangement, which results in these cohesive sticky ends. Overhangs. So here's an example of a cohesive cutter versus a blunt cutter. HIN3 recognizes the palindromic sequence AAGCTT. It then cleaves here between these two A's and these two A's, leaving a staggered cut, which is called a cohesive or sticky end. PVU2 recognizes the short sequence CAGCTG, the palindromic sequence, and it cuts bluntly. It cuts straight across, leaving blunt ends. Now, let's say you take one piece of DNA, right? You take one piece of DNA and you digest it with the enzyme HIN3. So you end up with these sticky ends. Then you take a different piece of DNA, a different gene, for instance, and you cut it with HIN3 as well, and you end up with sticky ends. Well, now by mixing the two, you could end up with this piece of DNA sticking to this piece of DNA, and they'll stick because of complementary base pairing with their sticky ends. And then with the help of, remember the enzyme ligase? Ligase fuses broken phosphodiester bonds in the backbone of DNA. So ligase will fuse this phosphodiester bond here, linking these two fragments, and it'll do the same here. It will add a phosphodiester bond here, linking the backbone here, this DNA. So now what have you done? You've just connected two fragments of DNA together by first cutting both pieces of DNA with the same restriction enzyme, and then allowing them to anneal with sticky ends, and then sealing the deal, sealing the backbone with ligase. So you see how, like, this is on the crude perspective on how genetic engineering works. You use these enzymes as scissors, okay, to cut DNA the way you want. You allow it to stick together, and then you glue with ligase. Restriction enzymes cut the DNA at specific sequences. Ligase glues. So everything's cut and paste. I want to cut this gene out. I want to paste it in this plasmid. I want to cut that gene out. I want to stick it next to this gene, etc., etc. I want to cut this promoter out, and I want to stick it in front of this gene. I want to put a different promoter in front of that gene. Cut and paste. That's how it works in the research lab. So concept check number one, where do restriction enzymes come from? Where did they originally come from? We discussed this. Think about it. From bacteria, right? The restriction enzymes come from bacteria. They are a natural defensive mechanism for bacteria. The bacteria produce these enzymes, and these enzymes are floating around in the bacterial cytoplasm so that if a bacteriophage were to inject its DNA into the cell, hopefully one of these restriction enzymes recognizes a sequence on that invading DNA, and that invading DNA is likely not methylated, and so it can attack and destroy and degrade that foreign DNA. You see, this is the importance of those restriction enzymes. But humans are clever enough. They took those restriction enzymes, the genes out. They then purified the restriction enzyme proteins, and we use those proteins for our cutting and pasting during genetic engineering. So let's see what your textbook said. It said restriction enzymes exist naturally in bacteria, which use them in defense against viruses, which is true. What are engineered nucleases? So instead of these restriction enzymes, which are natural nucleases, what are engineered nucleases? These are complex enzymes designed to make unique double-strand cuts in DNA at predetermined sequences. So these are things like zinc finger nucleases, or transcription activator-like effector nucleases, TALEN, or ZFNs. These recognize these recognize longer sequences than the typical restriction enzyme. Remember the restriction enzymes we just talked about, like EcoRI? Those restriction enzymes recognize sequences of only 4 to 8 BP. Well, that's not very helpful, because there could be thousands and thousands of copies of these sequences in a genome. What if you only want to cut one specific part of the genome? Well, then you're going to want to recognize a sequence maybe a little longer than just 4 to 8 BP, and that's where these zinc fingers and these transcription activator-like effector nucleases come into play. They could be engineered to recognize a very specific sequence. And nowadays, this is the gold standard by which we go about editing genes and recognizing sequences of genomic DNA. It's called CRISPR-Cas, and it's only come about in, let's say, the last 10 years or so. This is a new technology, but very exciting stuff, where scientists can now go in and try to edit the genome of organisms to try to fix genetic problems, right? And it's based off of, again, another naturally occurring system from bacteria and archaea. CRISPR-Cas was discovered in bacteria, and it's a system by which these bacteria can fight off certain viruses, fight off invading RNAs and invading DNAs. It's almost like a crude, very simple immune system for the bacterial cell. Let's say a bacteria was infected by a virus. Well, if the virus didn't take over the cell and destroy it, what the bacteria cell, let's say the bacteria cell was able to cleave that DNA with a restriction enzyme or something, well, then that fragment of DNA might have been incorporated into what's known as the cassette. You know, you've got these different fragments of foreign invading DNA all in a row with little linkers in between. And bacteria were able to use those fragments of foreign invaders past in order to pair up with a protein called Cas9. And anywhere those fragments are recognized in the future, they're double-strand cut for degradation. Okay? But humans... What was that? Okay. But humans have gotten wise to this technique, and they've cloned these CRISPR genes and Cas9 and whatnot. And now we use that technology in order to modify, specifically target and modify genomes of organisms we are looking at now. So we can, let's say, modify a sequence in your genome to fix a problem, a genetic problem, utilizing this system, this mechanism that's naturally occurring in bacteria. Okay, so let's read what it says here from your book. CRISPR-Cas9 makes a double-strand cut at a specific sequence, and you can dictate what that sequence is. You could engineer the sequence you desire. The DNA repair mechanism in the cell repairs the break, editing the target sequence, and if you can have a non-homologous end joining or homologous recombination occur after the break is made. And depending on which one of these is employed by the cell, you're going to get a different result. And I'm going to explain that in just a second. I'm going to explain it here. So here, this is CRISPR technology for editing a genome. So we're using this technology to edit the genome of an organism of interest. So what we need what's known as sgRNA. sgRNA, or single guide RNA, includes both the crRNA and the tracer RNA. These are the recognition RNA that we need. These RNA pair up with the Cas9 protein to form the effector complex. And this sequence here in the sgRNA recognizes a target sequence of interest in the target genome. So your effector complex of Cas9 and sgRNA binds to the PAM sequence on the genome. It then unravels the DNA, so the DNA double helix unravels, and then Cas9 causes a cut. Cas9 unwinds the DNA, and then it causes a cut, a cleavage in the DNA. Now, remember when we talked about DNA mutation, we talked that we discussed a mechanism by which your cells can repair DNA. If one of your chromosomes is cut, your cells can repair that cut one of two ways, either by what's called non-homologous end joining, which just joins the two ends, or by homologous recombination, which donor DNA or homologous DNA is used as a template to fix that problem, right? So those are the two ways by which your cells can repair cleaved DNA. And your cells will attempt to repair the cleaved DNA. Now here's the thing. If the cell does non-homologous end joining, this results in either a duplication or a deletion in this spot, and that could cause the gene to get destroyed. So that's one way of destroying a gene. If a molecular biologist or genetic engineer wants to destroy a gene, then allowing non-homologous end joining to occur is the way to go. You can destroy that gene and turn off that gene. Let's say it's a deleterious gene. Let's say it's a gene you're targeting that causes cancer, right? Well, then you could destroy that gene by allowing non-homologous end joining after CRISPR-Cas9 activity. But let's say you want to modify that gene. Like, let's say there's a, like, sickle cell anemia where there's a little point mutation and you want to fix that point mutation. Well, in this case, after you cleave the DNA, you would also add donor DNA, DNA that has the wild type sequence, and then hope that homologous recombination happens between the donor DNA and the host DNA, And if homologous recombination occurs, you could actually repair that missense mutation so that you have the correct nucleotide, the correct codon in the gene. So again, why is CRISPR-Cas9 so important? One, it can recognize 20 nucleotide regions, so really long, compared to a restriction enzyme. Remember, restriction enzymes can only recognize stretches of DNA that are 4 to 8 nucleotides long. Well, this recognizes 20 base pair long regions, which is very specific. You're not going to get too many of those in the genome, far less than an 8 nucleotide. Secondly, you can either use this system to destroy a gene through nonhomologous end joining, or you can use this system to repair a gene through homologous recombination. Isn't that neat? So moving on, let's talk about other techniques that scientists employ in the lab. Gel electrophoresis. This is a very important one. It separates DNA molecules or RNA molecules based on the size and electrical charge. These molecules are visualized by using a dye. And I think I mentioned the dye. It's actually a fluorescent molecule. It's an intercalating agent called ethidium bromide. We talked about this in the last chapter. It's a molecule that intercalates with the DNA and it fluoresces under UV light. So take a look here. Here you have an agarose gel, some kind of gel-like medium, kind of with the same consistency of an agar plate if you've had microbiology, but it's an agarose gel. You can then add your DNA samples with different size DNA. Like let's say you have 1,000 base pair fragment of DNA and a 5,000 base pair fragment of DNA, right? So you've got shorter DNA, longer DNA in this mix. You put that in a well and you want to separate the DNA based on size. You then apply a current, an electrical current. An electrical current. So what happens is, do you guys remember the charge DNA has? We discussed this in a previous chapter somewhere. I told you DNA is called an acid because it has an overall net negative charge. Remember that? DNA has an overall net negative charge. This means that overall, DNA is negatively charged, right? So if you apply a current, an electrical current, you could actually push DNA through a gel, right? So what you get, you'll have a negative electrode here, a negative electrode here, and then a positive here. So the cathode would be here. The cathode would be here and the anode would be up here, right? So negative charge up here, positive charge here. And guess what? DNA is attracted to the positive charge. So DNA starts traveling down the gel. And the smaller fragments of DNA travel faster than the large fragments of DNA. So this would be like 5,000 nucleotide DNA, 3,000, 2,000, 1,000, and then 500 BP. DNA. You see that? So you could separate DNA based on size and you'll get different fragments that correspond to each size fragment, to each size DNA. And then remember I said that the DNA was stained with ethidium bromide, this fluorescent intercalating agent. See, and then when you place this gel After electrophoresis, you put this gel on a UV source. The UV light causes fluorescence, okay? Fluorescence of the intercalating agent. So you can see here's a big band, a small band. Here's a big band, smaller band, right? So a heavier piece of DNA, a lighter piece of DNA. Okay, isn't that interesting? Concept check number two. DNA fragments that are 500 base pairs, 1,000 base pairs, and 2,000 base pair in length are separated by gel electrophoresis. Which fragment will migrate the fastest or the farthest? Well, remember the smallest piece. The smallest fragment will travel the fastest. So C. Yeah. Now, you can do gels like this, not just to detect DNA, but you can also detect RNA, you could detect protein, and you could utilize probes to see where is the sequence with a complementary that's complementary to your probe. So let's say you want to find you're running a piece of DNA and you want to find the insulin gene. You could make a probe which is like a short oligonucleotide, a short like primer, and you could mark that probe, and then you mix it with your DNA and run it on a gel, and wherever that probe is on the gel is where your target DNA is that you're interested in, where you're probe bound, right? So if you make a probe against insulin, you chop up the DNA and you run it, wherever the probe is, that's where your insulin gene is that it's stuck to, right? So that would be an example of southern blotting. You detect a specific sequence of DNA using a probe that marks the location of your target DNA. You can do the same thing with RNA. You can use a probe against a specific sequence of RNA, and you could run that. It's called northern blotting. You could do the same thing with protein. You could make an antibody probe against a specific protein and run that out on a gel, and then transfer that to a nitrocellulose filter. And you can see the protein. You can see the protein of interest in that gel. So if you want to see a DNA gene of interest, you can use a southern blot. If you want to find RNA of interest, a northern blot. And if you want to find a protein of interest, western blot, right? So isn't that interesting what we can do nowadays? We can take a cell, break it open, use probes to find a DNA of interest or an RNA of interest or a protein of interest using these different techniques. All of these techniques utilize gel electrophoresis and then some other kinds of processing, either with probes or something like that. Okay. PCR. Have you heard of PCR before? This is a big one in molecular biology. It's the polymerase chain reaction. Let's talk about PCR a little bit. So PCR is the process of amplifying a fragment of DNA. You have like a few, let's say you only have a few cells to work with, but you want to see a particular gene. You want to amplify that gene to thousands and millions and billions of copies of that gene. You could amplify a fragment of DNA. You can amplify a gene using PCR, right? And the enzyme is a polymerase. Remember DNA polymerase? DNA polymerase is able to copy DNA so that you can get lots of copies of that DNA. And what we do is we use a TAC polymerase, which means a polymerase from a thermophile, a hyperthermophile. This is a bacteria that likes hot conditions. This is because we need to use different temperatures in order to anneal the DNA and then melt the DNA apart during each replication cycle. So here's what we're doing. Here's our DNA we want to amplify, right? Here's the double-strand DNA we want to amplify. We heat it up to 90 to 100 degrees. That melts the two strands apart, right? You melt the two strands apart. Then you cool it to 30 to 65 degrees C to allow these primers, remember primers, how important they are for DNA replication, primers that you've already ordered, you know, that you've mixed into the reaction yourself ahead of time. Yes, you can order primers. Primers to anneal, and then you heat to 60 to 70 degrees to allow the TAC polymerase to copy the DNA. So here you get new copies of the DNA using the TAC polymerase, and obviously you need something to build with. So you got to use DNTPs. Remember the deoxyribotriphosphates? These building blocks of DNA. Okay, and then you just rinse and repeat. You heat again. You heat the two strands apart again at 90 degrees. You cool to 30 to 65 degrees to allow new primers to anneal. You heat to 60, 70 degrees again to allow elongation to occur, DNA synthesis to occur, and then you do this multiple cycles. People typically do this 17 to 22 cycles, and that amplifies your original DNA by millions of fold, And then you've got tons and tons and tons of copies of this gene. This is why, you know, if have you ever seen those crime shows where the guy's smoking the cigarette, then he throws the cigarette on the ground and somehow they get your DNA off that cigarette and they're showing it in the court case? This is how they do it. They get a few cells and a few copies of your genome off that cigarette, but then they're able to do something like a polymerase chain reaction in order to copy that gene many, 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 many fold, right? Like millions of fold. And then they're able to look at those genes for markers that are specific to you. It's like your genetic fingerprint, right? Which we're going to talk about a little bit. How do you do fingerprint analysis with genes? We're going to talk about at the end of this chapter. So what else can we do in the research lab? We could do gene cloning. We can clone a gene. Like, let's say I want to clone the insulin gene. I could get a copy of the insulin gene, right? I can amplify that gene in a bacteria cell. That means make clones of that gene. So if I took an insulin gene and I put it inside of a bacteria, the bacteria would make clones of that insulin gene. That's what gene cloning means. But in order to do gene cloning, I traditionally need to use a cloning vector. So I can't just stick a gene into bacteria and expect it to copy that gene. First, I need to stick my gene that I want to clone into what's known as a cloning vector, and then I can stick the bacteria, you know, I could stick the gene plus the vector into the bacteria. The bacteria will then clone my gene for me. I'm going to explain this in a second. So do you guys remember plasmids? We talked about plasmids when it came to bacteria cells. Plasmids, those circular DNA molecules from bacteria, they replicate independently of the bacterial genome. Remember all that? Well, guess what? I can insert foreign DNA of my choosing using my cut and paste technique. Remember, with restriction enzymes and ligase? Why can't I take a plasmid, cut it open, put a gene of my interest in there, ligate it in there, right? And then stick that plasmid with my insulin gene, for instance, into E. coli and expect the E. coli to make insulin. That's what I'm going to do, right? And when I infect the bacteria with naked DNA, do you guys recall from the previous chapter what that term is? Transformation, remember? Transformation of competent cells. We talked about that before. So if I stick my plasmid into E. coli, I'm going to transform competent cells. And then I'm going to screen for recombinant plasmids. I'm going to screen the bacteria to see which bacteria took up my plasmid of interest, including my my gene of interest, insulin, for instance. I could use not just plasmids, but if I want to inject more bacteria or clone, if I want to clone bigger pieces of DNA, I could use what are known as cosmids. I could use BACs, which are bacterial artificial chromosomes. I could use YACs, which are yeast artificial chromosomes. I could use the TI plasmid. This would be for cloning in plants. There's so many different ways to clone DNA of different sizes, but we're gonna mainly talk about plasmids because you already know what a plasmid is, and that's the most typical. So here's a plasmid. Here's a typical, everyday plasmid. So you have a circular piece of DNA with the ORI. Remember ORI-C, origin of replication. This is where the plasmid gets copied inside of the bacterial cell. Okay, it says number one, first a cloning vector must contain an origin of replication recognized in the host cell so that it is replicated along with the DNA that it carries. So, you know, this could be a plasmid from a E. coli, for instance, and it's got an origin of replication that E. coli could recognize and replicate so that it could replicate this whole plasmid. Okay, number two, secondly, it should carry some selectable marker, a trait that enables cells containing the vector to be selected or identified. So a selectable marker, for instance, would be, let's say, resistance to the ampicillin antibiotic, right? So imagine if you put a gene here. Imagine if you put a gene here and the gene was for resistance to ampicillin. Resistance to ampicillin antibiotic. Wouldn't that mean if I put this plasmid inside of a E. coli, that E. coli, if it did take up the plasmid, it would grow on ampicillin plus plates, right? Like a petri dish. Does that make sense? So let's say I have a strain of E. coli. If I were to grow that E. coli on the ampicillin antibiotic plate, would it grow? No. But if I were to inject it or transform it with this plasmid, then it would grow. Does that make sense? Because then it would have the gene for ampicillin resistance. That's called a selectable marker. Does that make sense? Then number three, third, a cloning vector needs single cleavage site for each of one or more restriction enzyme used. So remember the restriction enzymes, EcoRI, right? Remember SAL1, BAMH1, PSD1, HIN3. So these are sites that are recognized by those restriction enzymes I told you about before. Isn't that great? So guess what? If I cut this with EcoRI, if I cut this plasmid with EcoRI, it would open it up with sticky ends. And then what if I cut my insulin gene with EcoRI at each end? And then I glue my insulin gene right in here, and then use ligase to seal the deal. Now I would have cut this open and added insulin in here. Does that make sense? So let's see exactly how that process would have worked. Check it out. Here's my plasmid with my EcoRI site. There's two EcoRI sites. Or actually, no, this is one EcoRI site. It cuts here, and then it has a sticky cut like this, sticky ends like this. And then I have my foreign DNA, let's say the insulin gene with EcoRI sites at each end. I then digest my DNA. See, I digest the plasmid with EcoRI. I digest my insulin gene with EcoRI. I then allow them to anneal. And then I allow the ligase, DNA ligase, to fix the backbone of the DNA, fixing the phosphodiester bonds. And the nicks of the sugar phosphate bonds are sealed by DNA ligase. See, now this is my cloning vector. Now I've got a cloning vector. I've got a plasmid with its own origin of replication, an ampicillin resistance, for example, gene, selectable marker. And then I've got my insulin gene. Now I'm ready to go. Now I'm ready to inject this and transform this into competent E. coli so that those E. coli will grow and grow and grow and grow and grow and continually express my insulin gene, producing tons and tons and tons and tons of insulin. Does that make sense? That's exactly how genetic engineering works. Isn't that cool? So here it is. I'm gonna show you this, and we could take a quick little break time with Gizmo and Wicket, but I'm gonna show you how this cloning procedure works with two different kinds of markers. This is kind of cool. It's called blue-white selection. It's called blue-white selection. So here's a fancy way of getting the process I just told you with a cool color indicator at the end, so you can tell exactly which ones are your recombinant bacterium and which ones are not. So here's your plasmid. It's got a restriction site, like EcoRI, for instance. You cut that restriction site. You cut EcoRI. You open up the plasmid. You cut your insert with EcoRI, for instance. You know, this is your insulin gene, for example. You allow annealing to happen. And then you use ligase to seal the deal. Okay. And notice that the foreign DNA is inserted into a partial LacZ gene. Do you guys remember the term LacZ from before? We talked about the Lac operon. LacZ codes for beta galactosidase, the enzyme that breaks down lactose sugar. You remember that? So we're going to use that gene here. That's what genetic engineers do. That's what molecular engineers do. They take from this organism, they take that gene from that organism, and this gene from this organism, and kind of use them all in clever ways to manipulate genes, right? So we're sticking the insulin gene into the middle of a LacZ gene. Bacteria that are LacZ negative have are transformed by the plasmid. So you take bacteria that don't have LacZ, and you transform the competent bacteria with the plasmid. So now the bacteria have this plasmid, right, with LacZ. Number three, bacteria with an original non-recombinant plasmid produce beta-galactosidase, which cleaves X-gal and makes the colonies blue. So what this means is wherever you see a blue dot, wherever you see a blue dot, those are bacteria that got the plasmid. They got the plasmid, but the plasmid doesn't have the insulin gene inserted because the insulin gene would have disrupted the LACZ gene. I know. It's, look at this. You see this here? Up here? I know it's difficult, but bear with me. You see this here? This gene here? That's your LACZ gene. You cut the LACZ gene right in half, and you place your insulin gene between the LACZ gene. So you destroyed the LACZ gene. Does that make sense? If insulin didn't get inserted and you religated this back together, LACZ would work. And LACZ causes the blue color in these colonies. LACZ breaks down a compound known as X-gal to make a blue colony. So wherever you see blue colonies, that means that that particular E. coli got a plasmid, but not a plasmid with your insert of interest, not a plasmid with the insulin. However, bacteria with a recombinant plasmid do not synthesize beta-galactosidase. Their colony remains white. So the white colonies are the ones. The white colonies are the ones you care about because they're the ones that can't produce LACZ. And the only reason you can't produce LACZ is because your insert, disrupted the LACZ gene, right? And by the way, bacteria without a plasmid will not grow. Why? Because remember, they're ampicillin resistant. So you see this blue area of the plasmid? That's the gene for ampicillin resistance. This plate has the antibiotic ampicillin. So the only bacteria that grow on this plate are ones with a plasmid. The ones that are blue have the plasmid with no insert, and the ones that are white have the plasmid with the insert of interest. So if you were a genetic engineer, you would do this assay and you would get the white colonies and isolate, isolate these clones, right? You would isolate these clones of the white colonies on this plate, because those are the clones that got your plasmid plus your gene of interest, for example, insulin. Isn't that interesting? That's exactly how genetic engineers do this stuff. So with that, let's take a quick little break time with Gizmo and Wicket, and we'll be coming right back strong to finish this chapter. What do you say? Hey everyone, welcome back from break time with Gizmo and Wicket. Let's keep going. So remember I told you that plasmids are good, except for the fact that you can only fit so much DNA into a plasmid, about 15 kilobases, so 15,000 base pairs. But you might want to clone more than that. Some genes are bigger than that. So in that case, you could use lambda phage as your vector, or a cosmid, or a bacterial artificial chromosome. So you can fit up to 300,000 nucleotides into some of these vectors if you want to. And remember that a good plasmid needs to be able to be expressed. These are called expression vectors. If you want to express a gene and make the gene product, like let's say I want to put the insulin gene into E. coli and I expect E. coli to express that gene product into protein, because later on I might want to purify that insulin protein, I'm going to want to use what's called an expression vector. This here is an expression vector. You see, here's your here are your restriction sites. So this is where you would insert your insulin gene. Well, look what they have upstream of that. You've got a bacterial promoter. You've got your operator, right? So this is going to allow for gene expression to occur once you've transfected your cells or transformed your cells with this DNA, okay? and it also has a transcription termination sequence. So your insulin gene will be expressed, and you'll end up with gene expression inside of the bacterial cell. So concept check number three, how is a gene inserted into a plasmid cloning vector? Remember, we have to cleave the DNA with restriction enzymes, and we cleave the plasmid as well with restriction enzymes. Then we stick the two together at ligase, correct? And ligase seals the nicks in the phosphate sugar backbone DNA, and then we can transform our cells or transfect our cells. Next, let's talk about DNA libraries. This is a collection of clones. By clones, they mean genes, right? Clones of genes. You know, we're talking about molecular clones here. Clones means genes. Collection of clones all containing the DNA fragments from one source. What's a cDNA library? This is important. A cDNA library consists of only those DNA sequences that are transcribed into mRNA. So it's required for eukaryotic genes to be expressed in prokaryotic cells. So it's actually important that you understand the importance of cDNA, okay? Because remember that eukaryotic genes have exons and introns. Do you remember that? That eukaryotic genes have exons and introns? Well, don't those introns have to be spliced out if you want to end up with a gene product? Yes, but here's the thing. If I'm going to take insulin gene and put it into E. coli, how is E. coli going to express my insulin gene if my insulin gene has introns in it, right? It can't. It doesn't have an ability. So you know what we have to do? If we want our E. coli friend to express insulin, what we need to do is first get the cDNA. And what is that here? So here's an interesting thing. Let me see if I have the... check this out here. You see on this slide, reverse transcription PCR? Okay. So you want to express a eukaryotic gene in a prokaryote. You want to make insulin in a prokaryote, for instance. What do? Here's what you got to do. You have to use an enzyme from HIV called reverse transcriptase. Reverse transcriptase is an enzyme from HIV that can copy mRNA into DNA. So get this, I could take pancreas cells, right? I could take pancreas cells that transcribe the insulin gene. The pancreas cells will splice out the insulin introns, right? And then what are you left with after the pancreas has expressed insulin and then spliced out the insulin introns? You end up with the mature mRNA, correct? You have the mature mRNA that's ready for translation. Well, what if I were to take that mature mRNA and copy it back to DNA, right? That's called cDNA. All right, cDNA is a copy of an mRNA. So you won't have intron information there. Then I could stick that cDNA into my cloning expression vector, right? My expression vector, transform it into competent E. coli, and E. coli can readily read the cDNA, making mRNA with no introns, producing my insulin gene, my insulin protein. Isn't that cool? So again, I can't just take any human gene and stick it in E. coli and expect E. coli to make the right protein products, because introns and exons and all that. So what I need to do is first clone the cDNA for a particular gene by copying mRNA, reverse transcribing it to DNA called the cDNA, then cloning that cDNA into my vector, and specifically into a expression vector. So now I've got my cDNA for insulin cloned into my expression vector. I stick this in E. coli. The E. coli now has a promoter operator. It can transcribe my cDNA for insulin with no introns included, and I can make my insulin proteins. Isn't that cool? That's how it's done. So let's carry on. I'm sorry, where was I? Yeah, so you see now the importance of cDNA libraries. Nowadays they have, you know, these libraries of thousands of different cDNAs that you can buy out of a catalog, and you can get these cDNAs and then you can clone them and then express the proteins in whatever organism you want and then study those proteins or study the expression of those proteins. You could crystallize the protein, then figure out the structure of those proteins with X-ray crystallography, much like Rosalind Franklin did. You could do so many cool things nowadays. What else can we do? We could sequence DNA. We can actually take stretches of DNA and figure out the sequence. Like, what is the genetic A, G, C, T sequence of that DNA? It's called DNA sequencing, a technique to determine the sequence of bases in DNA. And the main method that's been used to figure out the sequence of DNA is the Sanger or dideoxy sequencing method, a method of sequencing DNA based on replication. The fragment to be sequenced is used as a template to make a series of new DNA molecules. These DNA molecules have different sizes, and based on the different sizes, you run them on a gel, and you're able to determine the genetic sequence of the DNA. Isn't that cool? Now, there are newer techniques coming out, better than the and faster than the Sanger method, but the Sanger method is still used today. It's really cool stuff. And then we're going to talk about DNA fingerprinting and profiling, how we can identify individuals based on their DNA sequences. So let's start with DNA sequencing. How does it work? Well, when we're talking about the Sanger method, this would be a typical DNTP, right? A typical deoxyribonucleoside triphosphate DNTP. So you would have an A, G, C, or T with three phosphate groups. But in order to allow the Sanger method to work, you need one of these modified DNTPs called the dideoxyribonucleoside triphosphate, which means it's missing not just the hydroxyl group on the 2' carbon of the sugar, but also the oxygen on the 3' carbon of the sugar as well. Now, when this nucleotide is incorporated into a growing strand of DNA, it can't be built on top of because there's no hydroxyl group here. So transcription or DNA replication effectively ends, right? So this is a good way to prevent any further DNA replication by incorporating a dideoxy, DDNTP. So how does his sequencing method work? You've got these dideoxyribonucleoside triphosphates, or DDNTPs, which lack that 3' hydroxyl group, which terminates DNA synthesis. Remember, because there's no hydroxyl group at the 3' end, you can't continue building DNA. And what you do is you take your template that you're trying to sequence. This is what you're trying to sequence. You make a primer against that template, and then you allow, you mix in some regular DNTPs and a polymerase, and then you add your DDNTPs like DDATP, DDCTP, DDGTP, DDTTP, and this will result in fragments getting formed, replicated fragments of different length. And then you'll run those different length fragments down a gel, and based on where those fragments lie on the gel, you can tell the sequence of the underlying DNA. Nowadays, this method has been automated such that you can actually use fluorescently tagged C's, G's, T's, and A's. So you've got fluorescently tagged DNTPs. And again, a laser will pick up which fluorophore, which color fluorescent molecule is attached to which nucleotide, and that would reveal the sequence of DNA. Isn't that cool? So we can sequence genes, we can sequence DNA. If you suspect that let's say a patient of yours, you suspect that the patient has a mutation in some gene. You could take samples of that patient and have those samples sequenced to see, oh, is there a G here where there should be an A? You know, and you could actually sequence that patient's DNA. Okay, concept check number four. In a dideoxy sequencing reaction, what terminates DNA synthesis at a particular base? Why is DNA synthesis terminated? Is it the absence of a base on the DDNTP halts the, no. Is it the DDNTP causes a break in the phosphate sugar backbone? No. Is it that the DNA polymerase will not incorporate a DDNTP into the growing strand? No. Is it the absence of that 3'OH we talked about? Yes. Remember, the DDNTPs are not just lacking a hydroxyl group at the 2' carbon, but also at the 3' carbon. So they can't be built upon once they're incorporated. Then you have the last concept of this chapter, DNA fingerprinting with, you know, when you're dealing with suspects in a crime scene, or you want to identify who's the father of who, you know, like those primetime TV shows or whatever, or daytime TV, I should say. It's like, you're not the father, or you are the father, or is this criminal? Is this suspect the criminal? We have DNA from a crime scene. You know, how does that all work? How do we link a person to a DNA sample? And it all has to do with microsatellites, which we've talked about before, these short tandem repeats that are very common in everyone's genetics. It's abbreviated STR, short tandem repeats, these microsatellites. Everyone's microsatellites, these repeats, are a little bit different, okay? And based on the differences of your unique microsatellite pattern, we call that your fingerprint. Just like everyone's fingerprints are unique, they're array of microsatellites, an arrangement of microsatellites, and number of microsatellites are going to be unique as well. Does that make sense? So this is going to be detected by polymerase chain reaction, PCR. And then you have these, you can analyze the fragment results on a graph. And if you have homozygotes for a particular microsatellite pattern, you'll get a single tall peak. If you have heterozygotes, you'll get two shorter peaks. So let's take a look at an example experiment. How can we identify people based on differences in their DNA? Okay, methods. So here you got individual one and individual two. You collect samples of DNA. So here's their DNA. And then you look at their microsatellite DNAs. You see these repeats here, the repeats. Here you've got 8 repeats of CA. So it's CA, 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 8 repeats of CA. This individual only has 2 repeats of CA. So what happens? So you PCR, you copy their repeats. You copy the repeats. Here I'm copying 8 copies of CA. Here I'm only copying 2 copies of CA because they only have 2 copies of CA. So then I get a long fragment of CA from this individual. I get a short fragment of CA from this individual. I run those fragments out to study those STRs. And what do I see with the short tandem repeats? I see a band, a heavier band, remember a longer DNA band up here from this individual after running the gel on, you know, the DNA through an agarose gel. Remember, you run the DNA, you put the DNA in the wells, and then you allow the DNA to run down the wells, and heavier DNA travels slower, lighter DNA travels faster. So I could tell these DNA samples are from two different people, right? This person, they had a lot more CA repeats than this person. This person had a lot fewer CA repeats. So conclusion, the patterns of DNA fragments produced by the individuals differ. So in this case, if this was the DNA from a crime scene and this was the prime suspect, that suspect would be excluded from the crime. And you could also look at STR fragments by looking at fluorescence as well. Not just you could analyze the actual fluorescence. So you could say at this locus, at this repeat, you know, this person was homozygous because there was a lot of fluorescence at that locus, but at this locus, they're heterozygous, and at this locus, they're heterozygous, homozygous. So again, this is just another way of analyzing that genetic fingerprint. And these are the different loci, right? The different spots that they analyze where the repeats live, okay? And which chromosomes they lie on. So we could say in chromosome 5, we're going to look at this locus. At chromosome 4, we're going to look at this locus. And then these are the number of repeats you expect to see for the number of alleles that you expect, right? So let's say you have a crime scene. This is my crime scene sample here. This is the banding pattern of my crime scene sample. And then I study the STRs from suspect 1, and then I study the STRs from suspect 2. So I see this one's homozygous at locus D21S11, and heterozygous for all three other loci. This one's homozygous at, you know, this locus and this locus. So which one of these suspects, suspect 1 or suspect 2, do you think committed the crime? This is the DNA from the crime scene. Well, I would rule out suspect 1, and it appears that suspect 2 matches the STR fingerprint from the crime scene. So this would be damning evidence for this person. This person is probably going to jail. Does that make sense? So concept check number 5, how are microsatellites detected? Again, we just showed you microsatellites are detected using PCR. So remember, polymerase chain reaction, with primers that flank the region containing the repeats, and then you run it on a gel, you could see the how big that those fragments are and compare it to the crime scene. Okay, now last concept, we're looking at other techniques, molecular techniques, to analyze gene function. Scientists want to know, what do genes do? We still don't know the function of every gene. Like, there are still, believe it or not, genes out there. We don't even know what the genes do. So how can we figure out the functions of different genes? Well, a lot of times you can use what's known as forward and reverse genetics. You can use mice. You could use transgenic techniques to make transgenic mice or transgenic organisms. So let's talk about this. With forward genetics, in order to figure out the function of a gene, you begin with a phenotype to a gene that encodes the phenotype. Begins with a phenotype to a gene that encodes the phenotype. With reverse genetics, you begin with a gene of an unknown function, first inducing mutations and then checking the effect of the mutation. Okay, so with forward genetics, you begin with a phenotype, and then you figure out the gene that caused the phenotype. Does that make sense? So let's say you have a mouse and it has a particular condition, like it's bald, right? Then you want to trace the gene. You want to figure out what gene is causing that phenotype. Does that make sense? But with reverse genetics, you start with a gene. You say, I know about gene 5. We don't know what gene 5 does, you know. Let's knock out that gene, or let's mutate that gene, or let's, you know, switch around that gene to see what is the phenotype there. Does that make sense? So again, with forward genetics, you start with the phenotype and you're trying to figure out what gene is responsible. With reverse genetics, you start with a gene and then you don't even know what that gene does, but you want to figure out what that gene does and what kind of phenotype would result if you mess with that gene. Okay, so concept check number 6. A geneticist is interested in the immune function of mice and induces mutations in a number of genes in the mouse. So the researcher is making mutations in genes and then figuring out which one of those mutations has impaired immune function. This is an example of forward genetics, reverse genetics, both or neither. I would say reverse because you're starting with messing with the gene and then you're looking at the phenotype. So it's reverse genetics. Awesome. Carrying on. Transgenic techniques. So this is the process of making transgenic animals, which means animals that have introduced genes. You've put a new gene into this animal. An organism permanently altered by the addition of DNA sequence into its genome is a transgenic mouse. So if I take a new gene, a new gene and I stick it into a mouse, and that mouse now has that gene and it can pass on that gene, that's a transgenic mouse. Does that make sense? Transgene, foreign DNA that a transgenic organism carries. So here you can see two mice. This is a wild type mouse, and then this is its litter mate who has a transgene. It has a gene that induces more obesity. This gene causes obesity. Okay, so you got the wild type litter mate and then the mutant transgenic, the transgenic with the gene that causes obesity. Now, how do you make transgenic animals? Look at figure 14.19. Transgenic animals have genomes that have been permanently altered through recombinant DNA technology. In the photograph, a mouse embryo is being injected with foreign DNA. So take a look here. You've got mice. These mice, this is a female mouse and a male mouse. Mice are mated and fertilized eggs are removed from the female mouse. So you've got a fertilized egg. Foreign DNA is injected into the pronuclei. So you've got an actual injection of foreign DNA into the pronuclei of the egg. And this is an actual picture of the process occurring. These are very fine pipettes and needles. The gene of interest is then introduced, like I said, into the fertilized egg. Embryos are implanted in a pseudo-pregnant female. So those embryos are implanted into a pseudo-pregnant female, and then the offspring grow, right? The embryos grow inside. Offspring are then tested. So you take a little tissue sample and you test it for the presence of the transgene by PCR. So you'd PCR a little sample, usually a little tail sample, from all these mice for the presence of your transgene. And look on here, it looks like transgene A, or transgenic A, C, and D. These are the pups with the transgene. So I would keep those three pups, and those are my transgenics. And then I could even cross those transgenics to propagate my cell line, to propagate my my transgene line, right? So now I've got stable transgenics that I could propagate. I could cross them more. Hopefully I have a male and a female transgenic that I could then propagate, so I can carry on that line of mice. And I could study the effect of adding that gene to the mouse. Isn't that cool? So that would be what are called gain of function research, looking at new genes function in a mouse. What happens if I add this gene to the mouse, right? Now, what's the opposite of that? Knocking out a gene, removing a gene from a mouse, right? That's called the knockout mouse. Knockout mouse, you delete a gene. Knock in mouse, a mouse carries an inserted DNA. So this transgenic was kind of an example of knock in. A knockout would be destroying a gene, okay? And that process is very similar, by the way. You would take pluripotent stem cells, you would then put DNA linearized DNA into stem cells. There'll be homologous recombination between the linearized DNA that you introduced into the stem cells and the genome of the mice. That homologous recombination could knock out a very important exon, like exon 1 of a gene. That essentially effectively knocks out the protein in those stem cells. You would then inject the stem cells into an egg. You would inject those stem cells into an egg, then implant into pseudopregnant female, and then you would screen for knockouts in the progeny. So very similar technique, except you have to do a little, it's a little bit harder to make a knockout than a transgenic. A knockout requires that you get stem cells, you induce homologous recombination in the stem cells, then you make your knockout animal. Transgenic, you don't need to deal with that. You just introduce the transgenic gene into the pronuclei of a fertilized egg, and it's a lot quicker process, right? But you could do either. Again, you could introduce a gene, you could remove a gene, and this is how scientists study gene function. By adding a gene or removing a gene, you can determine the function of that gene, right? Isn't that interesting? So again, here's the stats board for the mouse. Musculus coming in strong as a strong model organism, a genetic model organism. Advantages closely related to humans. It's got the same, you know, it's got similar organs to us. It's got the heart, the pancreas, the liver, and all that. It's got a small size, rapid reproduction, large litters. You can study development. You know, it's great for cancer genetics, immunogenetics, model of human genetics, embryology, development, all that good stuff. It's a mammal, and it's just a great model organism. Usually only takes 19 days gestation, or 19 to 21 days for a birth to occur from mating, and then only 5 to 6 weeks for maturity, and they're ready to mate some more. So within the course of one PhD, you know, a PhD program takes about 5-6 years. In the course of 6 years, you can have many, many, many generations with mice. You can make transgenic mice, knockout mice. You can do all kinds of neat things and study genes and then determine the functions of genes and determine why those genes might be important in humans. So very, very powerful, very, very powerful model organism. And again, biotechnology has limitless potential. Pharmaceutical, with specialized bacteria, agriculture, genetic testing, gene therapy, you name it, especially now with CRISPR-Cas9, it's the sky's the limit with what we can do with genetics and genetic engineering. Very interesting stuff. Very, very cool. If you have a chance, work in a research lab. You know, go and find a research lab to do these types of techniques in. A lot of them will be more than happy to give a chance for either an internship or to serve as a technician or something like that. And, you know, it's great experience whether you want to go to graduate school or medical school to learn these techniques and do something cool and figure out something new. It's fun. All right, so I hope you were excited by this stuff. I know I am. It's very interesting stuff. I know it's confusing, though. So if you're confused at all, you have any questions, please leave them in the comment box below, and I'll catch you guys next time.
Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. A Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. A Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. A Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D. Dr. D, Dr. D, Dr. D.